see if you want me to stay on or not. You're letting me.
Okay, that sounds good. What's going on, fam? Hotep, Hotep, it's Thursday. You know what that means. It means it's time for some Dr. Clyde Winters Black History Gems. It is First Frequency of One, the Shock Metaphysics. I'm your dude. I'm your guy. Shocktimus Prime, Shockalicious, Shook, Shock, Rev Shock, Uncle Phil of Philosophy. But of course, it's just the metaphysical Morpheus coming at you with another amazing conversation, another amazing class, another amazing lesson. Dr. Clyde Winters, how are you, Bobo?
I'm fine today, and how are you?
I'm good. It's 90 degrees here. What's going on over there in your temperature?
It's in the 70s, but a lot of melanin. I've been out there soaking up the sun.
Love it, man. Love it.
I was, you know, people may have thought I was white. The only thing I had my shirt on.
You're getting that neuromelanin, baby. I love it. I love it.
We've been in the house too long, man. We've been
in the house too long. It affects you. It affects you. I know I get cabin fever all the time because I'm always here. So, yeah, absolutely. No doubt. Now, you know you kicked ass last week with the piece that you did with the ancient Egyptians. But this one is different. This one here is another, because I asked you and I said, what are you doing next week? Oh, I don't know. I'll let you know. And then you finally sent it to me. So why did you choose this particular topic tonight afternoon?
Well, what we're going to talk about tonight is the role of Egypt in the foundational Black American and Dalit curriculum. The Dalits are an underclass people in India. They're mm-hmm. Black. And what we're going to talk about is why we both see Egypt as a focal point. You see, why is it that these Black people in India, why do they want to be associated with that? Also, mm-hmm. what is the relationship between the Dalits or Tamils and foundational Black Americans? You know, mm-hmm. There was a lot of controversy when Kamala Harris was made vice president. Was she Black or what? And what we're going to do today is we're going to talk about this whole idea. How long have foundational Black Americans and Dalits been interacting? You know, as much longer than people will really know. A lot of people don't know, in a sense, this whole idea of how Egypt plays such an important role in how we see the world. You know, how Egypt has been an inspiration to all of us. But what mm-hmm. makes Egypt so beautiful is that Egypt was the first B1 nation. Mm-hmm. A lot of people understand that. You know, a lot of people, mm-hmm. especially a lot of brothers over here and sisters, and even some people around the world, they always think that we call ourselves Blacks because of our interactions with the white man or with Europeans.
No, that's not true.
That's a lie.
That's not true.
Because the Egyptians, it wasn't any Europeans around them. It wasn't any mm-hmm. whites around them. And they mm-hmm. called themselves Black.
Right.
This is something that we have to understand, is that stop trying to feel that there has to be a relationship between us and white people to call right. us Black.
Right, right. It's part of that trauma and toxicity. We hate white so much we don't want to be Black. That's really what it is. But you're also on point, beloved, obviously, because I had a linguist on, Dr. Obadeli Cambone. Oh, this is maybe about 4, maybe 5 years ago. And he ripped it. He had an amazing PowerPoint. He was educated in Harvard. He lives in Ghana, went back home to Ghana, has this huge institute. And he too said that, and showed the PowerPoint. Now he said, hey man, Khmer Rouge, the land of the Black. It's everything goes back to linguistics. When you look at the linguistics, they refer to themselves as Black. And this is, like you said, this is before any whiteness or any European ever showed up on the planet.
You know, but although he said that, although Professor Kaboom said that, you'd be surprised that there's still a lot of people over here who are trying to say that it doesn't mean Black. That doesn't mean Black and that as a result, we should reject the teachings of the great master, Anti-Giap. You know, and these people have some influence. You'd be surprised, because so many young people, they don't read. They don't read, they don't study, and they haven't read Diop. And so, you know, they honestly believe some of this stuff. There's one guy, he comes on every weekend attacking Diop and attacking.
Wow.
Yes.
He comes really? There's an idiot out there that would do such a thing?
Yes. Yes.
Really?
And he has a pretty strong following.
Wow.
And
I mean, this is indicative of what happens, right? We have seen this happen throughout the history as it relates to us. There's just some of us that no matter what, we're not going to make it. We're not going to get out. The trauma, the indoctrination, and the hatred of the Amu is so strong that you're willing to throw the baby out with the bathwater. And the main thing that is, as Dr. Marie Charles taught us, it was only one culture. It was only one culture, and that culture was Kemet. That culture was Egyptian culture. There was a black culture. So I don't know how to save those people. I really don't know how to help them. I just leave them to their own devices, and maybe they'll come around like some of us did. You know what I'm saying?
They might, but the thing about it is that, you know, him and his followers, they really believe that they're being Africologists. They really believe that they're really standard bearers. And so
where is their paperwork? Are these scholars? Are they authored? Do they have articles? Are they published? What's going on with that?
They've done some tapes. They've done a lot of videotapes, and one of them, he's written a little book, but the thing is, this is that none of his stuff has been published except by himself, and I publish a lot of stuff myself, so I can't criticize that.
Mm-hmm, sure.
But what I can criticize, and what we're going to talk about later today, is how you can be so foolish. I hate to call people dumb. I hate to call them foolish.
Right.
Because see, as a man, I know my father taught me that, you got to be careful. You know, I mean, I used to wear a jacket up to 35, up to the age of 35. Even in the summertime, I wore a jacket. And the reason I wore a jacket, because I wanted to be ready to take it off and roll it around my left hand in case I got in a knife fight.
Mm-hmm.
So then, you know, I know that most of the people out there, they think that's silly, but I mean, hey,
I did it too, bro.
You know,
it was Chicago. That was a different world. There's a different world.
It is a different world. But the point is, this is that I do know this, that you have to keep your head up. But at the same time, you know, it's just so many people gang banging. You know, my family came to Chicago in the 1920s. In the 1960s, when Jeff Ford and the leader of the Disciples came up, they came straight up from the South, wasn't any jobs or nothing. So they wanted to do what most immigrants do. What most immigrants do is they start a gang.
Mm-hmm.
They feel if they start a gang, they can make some money, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And and so they got money from the Catholic Church. Both of them operate out of Catholic churches.
Wow. Great history story. Great history lesson. Didn't know that.
They both met at Catholic churches. W. Clement Stone, he was the richest man in Illinois. He would buy him guns.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. I remember him.
And even up to today, every couple of years, there's always a train that somehow is marauded on the southeast side in Inglewood that's full of guns. Somehow the train gets stopped, and all the gangbangers know to get there and get them some guns. But again, so this PDF is going to be very interesting to those people who really want to know about this relationship.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a very important thing, you know. But again, many people who don't have the PDF from last week, you're going to be a minority, because see, that's going to end up being a really powerful PDF on the space travel, because see, most of the people, they don't, they want to keep, they believe that that inscription is a joke, and they mm-hmm. believe in the sense that you just, they believe you just think you see helicopters and you mm-hmm. think you see airplanes.
Mm-hmm.
See,
right? It's crazy.
Yeah, but they don't understand that it's an inscription that has three meanings. It has a meaning for Ramses I, Ramses II, and Ramses I, his son Seti I, and then Ramses II. And it's a beautiful thing. And it used to, somebody tried to put plaster on it. But you know, the plaster, the plaster was put on it clumsily, and the plaster fell off. That's how they saw the helicopters and stuff like that.
Oh, wow.
Yeah,
it was. Wow. So they tried to cover it up.
Yeah, they tried to cover it up, but I guess, you know, sometimes they have earth movements over there in Egypt, and the plaster fell off, and so now they're trying to explain it away. But see,
that's why
you had to have a cross-disciplinary approach, you see.
Mm-hmm.
See, the reason that I could get more out of it is because of the fact that I do understand, I have read the Ramayana. I have seen what I know, in a sense, that it's about Ramses I. See, and so if it's talking about them flying, then you find a girl on the moon, and then mm-hmm. there's letters on the ship. There's mm-hmm. letters on the ship.
Mm-hmm.
And so then it's just interesting, very interesting, you know. Because see, I'm beginning to see it was an I know about the Maya civilization, but in a lot of the Indian. Like in a lot of the Rig Veda, Mahabharata, and some of those books, they keep talking about the Sioux. So I'm really trying to research that, but it's kind of hard. But because it was also a Sioux civilization, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But again, I haven't been able to put that all together yet. Maybe I'll put it together one day, you know.
And certainly you will.
It's just very hard, you know. And
so walk us through. Also, you have again. I don't know how you do this, but you have a pretty amazing PDF special report download that comes with this. What are we going to learn on the PDF?
As I said, it's going to be mainly about the relationship between Black people in India and the Dalits in India and Black people here, and why we see Egypt as the source of our inspiration, as the source of our power as a people, even though we live thousands and thousands of miles away, even though our hair has a different texture, you see, in many cases, you know, but again, we're still black, be one first.
Mm-hmm. Be one. Absolutely.
And see, that's the biggest problem. And that's what we have to fight. We have to get people to understand that the only way towards the future is to be one in our mm-hmm. fight against white supremacy. You see, foundational Black Americans are the only ones who fight white supremacy. You know, mm-hmm. over in Britain, they don't like to call them white supremacists because they think that that's giving them honor. So they call them terrorists, you know.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But see, over here, mm-hmm. we're fighting white supremacy because of the fact that we feel that because they want to feel they're supreme, we have to show that they're not supreme. So that's why
mm-hmm. mm-hmm.
it's a different attitude. But again, both of us are aiming for the same thing. But what it's all about is trying to make sure, in a sense, that we fight these people. So this PDF is about the relationship between Black people in America and Black people in India over the past 500 years.
Phenomenal. Now, you have a PowerPoint with us for us as well, right?
Yeah, let me share it.
Okay.
Ah, I didn't bring it up yet. Ah, wow. Silly me.
We'll wait.
Yeah, I've been up since 2:30 and I couldn't go back to sleep, so.
Almost there, fam. Okay. All right. There we go. There we go. All right. Whenever you're ready to go full screen and start, Doc, I'll go full screen for you. And bam, there you go.
Okay. Egypt, Dalits, and Foundational Black Americans. It's very important to understand that that people around the world follow our leadership, you know. Many people, they don't know that we've always been a great influence because of the fact that we dare to stand up to white supremacists. And although other people live in different other countries, and other people may have their own country, it makes them feel that anything is possible because of the fact that as foundational Black Americans, we will try to fight, no matter what the cost. And this has been inspiration to many people. You can go to my Patreon to see the slides. I was going to have a talk today on my Discord and my Patreon, but I'm a little tired since I've been up since 2:30 a.m. So, I don't know how, I don't feel that real, invigorated. My Twitter is at Dr. Clyde Winters 8. And don't forget to go to YouTube and see my videos. What is FBA? FBA is not a group. FBA is not an organization. FBA is a lineage. A lineage is lineal descent from an ancestor, ancestry or pedigree. As a result, we are descendants of the African and Aboriginal Blacks who built the United States. We are Aboriginal Black Indigenous people native to the United States. FBA ancestry is African. FBA heritage depends on our tribal origins and presence in the various states. Yes. We have different heritages depending upon the states that we came from. And yet these heritages, we should not let them overwhelm the fact that we all belong. We all belong to Mother Africa.
Yes, Ashe.
We all belong to Mother Africa. And that no matter the fact, in a sense, that we are foundational Black Americans, our ancestors, our great ancestors, for the past 100,000 years that came to these here in North America and South America, for 100,000 years, they came from Africa. Aboriginal foundational Black Americans were the first slaves in the United States, yes. When the British came and got slaves, they didn't get slaves and take them to the Caribbean from Africa. That came later. They didn't get slaves and take them, in a sense, to Britain from Africa. That came later. The British hunted down Black Indians and sold them into slavery.
Mm-hmm.
They also gave them a lot of gifts. But the gifts they gave them were blankets, and these blankets had smallpox. They used germ warfare. Many of the earliest English colonies that came to the United States, they came to the United States almost near winter. Think about it. Back in those days, you had to build your own house. Have you ever wondered why these people would come to the United States almost near winter and not have any place to stay? They had a place to stay. They knew, in a sense, that many of those African log cabins, those African forts that the Black Indians had built was available for them. Yes. You got to remember, you see, as I talked about last week, you see a lot of Aboriginal Black people want to think that their ancestors were Igalas or Sioux. They want to think that they went around in teepees. No. Aboriginal Black people, they built cabins. They built forts because they stayed in one place and grew crops. They grew, in a sense, the three sisters, maize, beans, and squash. Damn, I ate so much squash growing up. Damn, I used to mama! Cook something else. Squash and tomato dumplings.
Oh my God. Tomato dumpling. Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
That's hilarious.
Yeah, because they grow tomatoes, they can the tomatoes, and then they cook the tomatoes, and then they put dumplings in, biscuits, dough. So I mean,
yep. Hey,
so it was okay. Identity matters. Terms of use to make foundational Black Americans invisible. They called us colored. Then they called us minorities. And then they gave everything to the minorities. They didn't mm-hmm. give it to us. They called us colored. And then they called, in a sense, the Mongoloid Indians. They said they were the Native Americans. No, these people weren't the Native Americans. They came to North Carolina. They came to Georgia. They came to these countries years and years and hundreds of years after we had already been settled there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Then they called us African American. And then all it did is make everybody else that came from anywhere, even some people from India. Even some people from India, they cut their hair real short and said, I'm an African American too, to get those scholarships, get those grants. The European second frequency is always trying to find a way to offer us something and then take it away.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
That's why we don't want land. We don't want to go to college for free.
Mm-hmm.
We want a check. Why? With a check, mm-hmm. you can buy land.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
With a check, mm-hmm. you can go to college, right?
Mm-hmm.
Get that mm-hmm. other stuff, because look, they always take it away. There are over 65,000 foundational Black Americans fought in the Civil War to free themselves. In fact, it was almost 200,000 Black people that fought in the Civil War when you count the people who were in the Navy, the people who did the supply lines. Yes, yes. So when they tell you, in a sense, that they gave, that Lincoln freed the slaves, that's a damn lie. We freed ourselves.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
See, mm-hmm. We took a gun and we freed ourselves.
We need to know this history. We need to know this. You need to know our truth.
You got to know this. You got to stop putting on your, going out with your hand hanging out, and begging people to give you something. They're not going to mm-hmm. give you nothing. Mm-hmm. We have no allies. No allies.
Facts.
No allies. You hear us always talking about Black and brown. Look at now, those people got killed up in Buffalo. And they instead of just saying Black people got killed, oh, the people of color got killed. Oh, they killed the Jews. No, they killed Black people.
Mm-hmm.
And are we mm-hmm. gonna have, when are they going to give us an anti-hate crime?
Mm-hmm. An anti-hate bill. Yes. Yes.
Where's
come
our
on now.
Intelligentsia?
Come on.
We don't
now.
Have any intelligentsia. We don't have any leaders who are standing up demanding rights for Black people.
That's
not
right.
Not people of color. The Latinos, they identify as white. Look at their damn census forms.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The Asians, they identify as Asians.
Mm-hmm.
There are no people of color except another FBA
mm-hmm,
or immigrant mm-hmm. from Africa. Everybody else is in the white realm, or they've been given honorary white status.
Mm-hmm.
They're not going to give mm-hmm. you honorary status. To you, you're just another.
Yep.
FBA culture is American culture. The food, the music, the language. I don't have to go into it. A lot of
nope.
people, there's some people say, Dr. Winter, shut up. Why? Why? Dr. Winter, you know damn well that the white man gave us apple pie. That's a lie.
That's what we love about you. Like, that's a lie.
And then he said, hey, Dr. Winter, the white man gave us baseball. No, we were playing that already as Indians. Dr. Winter, stop. 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 Look at the cookbooks. The white man wrote the cookbooks. Yeah, it's all about fried chicken. Before another Europeans came to USA, we built the roads. We opened up the land. We cut down the trees. We grew the crops. You know, the number one crop that made America rich? You know what made America rich? was cotton.
Mm-hmm.
Cotton made mm-hmm. the banks rich. Cotton made the insurance companies rich. Yes, they had insurance on your... Oh!
Mm-hmm. Yes. Come on.
They Say insured it. The slaves. You were worth thousands of dollars.
Mm-hmm.
Back then, you couldn't kill a black person. That's mm-hmm. why slavery, they found it to their advantage to be able to string us up, to lynch us, to burn us. Every evil thing they could do.
Mm-hmm. Castration.
Right, mm-hmm. we didn't have the protection.
That's right.
See, American technological superiority is made by us. We made the damn up. We made everything. We made the tubes. We made the damn, we made the first digital phones. We made all that stuff. The only thing about the European, he make it look pretty. Yes, he make it look pretty.
Mm-hmm.
See, you know, I remember in the 70s, a brother found a way to run cars off water.
I remember that.
You see, you know, today, look, even in Africa, the damn brother's kicking butt. I just read in the newspaper, this brother in Africa, he can see TV.
He did what?
He found a way to be able to look at TV without electricity.
Oh, damn. Wow. See, wow. Genius we are.
Somehow.
See, that's tapping into the Akashic records that you're talking about. That's tapping into that genetic memory.
That genetic memory.
That's what it is. Yep, see, I like that. Look,
that's why they covered up the helicopter glyph.
Mm-hmm.
Because they covered up the helicopter glyph that if black people in a sense had helicopters, airplanes, rockets, we still mm-hmm. don't know how they still don't know how we built the pyramid.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Look
that's
at
true.
Those beautiful monuments. Anybody that's been to Egypt will go in those temples. Those temples, it's dark. How did they light them up?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They don't know because we are the creators.
Mm-hmm.
We are mm-hmm. the inventors. They're the fabricators. They take what we make and make money.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. What's the next one? Because that's the truth.
They make them look
That's
cheap.
The truth.
Black people, every time we have try to seek economic independence, they always, in a sense, try to obstruct it. Rosewood. Black Wall Street. Even today, anytime they see that you're about to make some money. Look at Tariq Nasheedy want to build a museum. Every time he find a place that's for sale, they'll give him the runaround. They want mm-hmm. to sell him the damn building.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because they don't want us to have nothing. Nothing. Mm-mm. Nothing. 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 And that's why I know God exists. I know Emma exists.
Absolutely.
I know if it was not for Emma, we wouldn't have.
We wouldn't be here. And if it wasn't for Emma and for us being first and having the DNA to be able to handle this, we wouldn't have been here.
That's right.
We wouldn't have been here.
We got the 9 strands of DNA.
Mm-hmm.
You know those 9 strands of DNA? That means that in a sense, it works on the T cells. The T cells. Mm-hmm. Protect you! The T cells deal with medicine! Look! No matter what the statistics they give you of what happened during the so-called pandemic, the majority of our people, they died
mm-hmm.
because of other complicating factors. They're not dying in Africa like that.
Mm-mm. Mm-mm.
The only place they're dying in Africa is South Africa. And who lives there? Second frequency.
Come on now. Come
on. Calling out frequency. Second frequency, bite.
Say that. Oh, I love it.
And then remember, we adopted the Aboriginal Mongoloid people. We adopted these nomads. They didn't know how to farm and they still don't know how to farm. They didn't grow out of crops, and they don't know how to grow crops today.
Mm-hmm.
They gave them our identity. We are the 5 civilized tribes. But you wouldn't know that if you looked on the daggone computer. Now you see the pilgrims. You see the pilgrims was white. and the five civilized tribes of white, $5 Indians.
Ain't that something?
You know, if you want to know, today we're talking about the black people of India, the Dravidians. If you want to find out more about the black people, the Dravidians of India, you can buy these books, The Dravidian Connection. And there I talk about how the Dravidian people left Africa and they moved and settled in different parts of the world, especially parts of Eurasia, like China, stuff like that. In my other book, Ancient History of Tamils in Central Asia, you want to get this book because it'll tell you the history of Dravidians in Central Asia, how the Indo-Europeans adopted their culture. And after they adopted their culture, in a sense, we still dominated them. And then my decipherment of the Indus Valley writing, my decipherment of the Indus Valley writing, Dravidian, is the language of the Indus Valley. This book will tell you how to read the Indus Valley inscriptions. Next week, we may discuss these inscriptions to show you this literacy. See, as I've been trying to tell you, they try to teach you that we're an oral people. We're just not an oral people. We're illiterate people. Illiterate people. Look, last week when I talked about the spaceship flown to the moon by the Egyptians, they had letters on that. They had words on that to let you know your history, because your history is in front of your face. But they tell you, and you believe, that it's somebody else's history. No, it's yours. In my book, An Unofficial History of Dravidian Writing, I talk about all the various Dravidian scripts that they use in South India. Tamil, Malayalam, etc. Then if you want to know, get my book, The Nile Valley History in the Rig Veda. In the Nile Valley History in the Rig Veda, I talk about, in a sense, how the Dravidian people originated in the Nile Valley. Yes, the Nile Valley. And from the Nile Valley, they moved into India. I wrote another book where I talked about how, in a sense, even the people in much of Australia and much of the South Seas, they came from the Nile Valley too. You might not believe it, but many of the place names, I think we may have talked about many of the place names in the South Seas, Oceania, Melania, many of the place names, many other towns and cities are the same place names that we have in West Africa. Yes, West Africa, because it's the same people. But second frequency will tell you that there's no relationship. Second frequency will tell you that the only Negroes live in West Africa. That's a lie. That's a lie. Black people were on every continent. Black people, we made this world. We made this universe.
That's right. Come on now. Speak that truth.
Black as you. Black as me. Black as us. Black is free.
Proud to be black. Proud to be black. Say it loud. Say it loud.
I'm black and I'm proud.
Come on now.
And then also, you might want to get my book, The World History of the Black Race. In the world history of the black race, I talk about us everywhere. Yesterday, I did a presentation on the Sister Shanice show. I want you guys to really check it out.
It was amazing.
Thank you. I saw you in the chat later when I looked.
Yeah, absolutely. I wouldn't miss that for the world.
You was one of my best boosters, baby.
All day, every day. All day, every day.
Thank you. Thank you, Reverend Shot.
Absolutely. You know, absolutely.
And it's called Europe Was a Black Continent. It's all you had to do is go to the Sister Shanice show, and you can find this. I want you guys to support it. You're going to find some valuable information. You know, on how Europe was a black continent.
All right, hold on a second, Doc. I'm actually trying to find that link so I can put that in the chat of your appearance yesterday on Sister Shanice's show. Oh, here it is. I got it. I found it. Hold on, fam. because we need to, y'all need to support that. Hold on a second. I'm going to put this in the chat and then we'll move forward. Okay, here we go. Putting that in the chat. Go check that out, fam. All right. Now, while the fam's doing that, you need to answer this question, Doc. Does Kemet mean black land and black people?
Yes. Black people can be B1 based on culture, history, and land. The ancient Chinese, they call themselves Li Min, black people. The Assyrians, they call themselves Salmakahadi, black people. The Sumerians, they call themselves Sagiga, black people. The Aztecs, they call themselves Mashika, lords of the black land. And the Olmec called themselves She, black people. But the most famous, the most important group that called themselves black people were the ancient Egyptians, the Kemetians, the Kemetians. But do you know, there's a brother, his name is Asar Imhotep. Every week, he's having shows talking about Anti-Geop, the master, the leader, the brother who went up against all the white Egyptologists in the world.
You're saying he's talking about Sheikh Anta-Geop?
Yes, Asar Imhotep.
Really?
Yes. Yes.
Really?
Yes.
That's shocking.
My father.
Wow.
Daddy-o, I called him.
Look at that.
He said, Clyde, be a man. He said, Clyde, a man must have his word. He said, I don't care how much money you ever get in your life, son. He said that your word must stand for something.
Mm-hmm.
You see, if you talk to any student I had in grammar school, high school, they'll tell you, always told them, let's shake hands. Do you really mean this? If you mean this, give me your word.
That's right. How old were you in this photo?
I was about, 21, 20. I was about 21. I was playing football then.
Okay. You had a football voice back then?
Yeah, I had a different voice back then. that's when I was caught on campus, you know,
That's right. Yes, you know, yes. I have so much fun with you. Did you? Lord.
White girls call me Superman and the white girls call me Super Pod.
I love it. I bet you could find some people that's going to call you the same thing today. I bet you can.
I bet you can, but my father said, if you call a man a liar, you got to be ready to fight. Here we have this guy, Ansar Imhotep. He pretends that he's really an anthropologist. He pretends that he's a linguist. He's not a linguist. He's not an anthropologist. Look at what he's doing. These are his shows. His last two shows. What does he say?
Wow.
Diop did not show his work on the word Kemet.
Somebody say sheesh.
Meaning yep. Kemet again.
There it is.
Focusing on the discussion.
Somebody said Imhotep did not say anything negative about Diop. It was all positive. And now then you show the slide. Yep. What that's called it? Social proof, fam. You know, you're not making this ish up. This is what's happening in the community. Everybody wants to be right, but nobody wants to be free. Because when we talk about one culture, that's freedom. When we talk about all of these different heritages and all of these different who said what and this scholar over that scholar, that's why we're in the situation that we're in. And those type of people won't get out because you got too much confusion. Because you just want to be right. You don't want to be free.
And not only that, but see a lot of
black. And not taking anything away from Brother Asar. I don't know him. I met him once and seemingly a great guy, a great person, a great dude. I don't know his scholarship, That wasn't something that I never reached out to him to have him on the platform. After I asked around to various different scholars, they kind of shared with me, you know, who this brother is. And I just made a decision based upon that information that, okay, you do you, and I'll just, you know, work with a certain group of scholars on my platform over the next, you know, 7 to 10 years or whatever, and do what we do. Doesn't make him a bad person. It's just his information. Sometimes we have to put 100 on 10 so we can get some attention. And that's what we do. And that's to the detriment of us.
See, he's part of the hip hop culture. And the hip-hop mm-hmm. culture, if you notice, the rappers always try to knock another rapper down. And so,
right.
so this young man has the nerve to say that, sorry, DF did not show his work on the Word Cameron. These are the last two programs he did. You can go right now, look on YouTube, if you think I'm lying, and you can see other ones. The two before this, he was attacking DF. But he said that DF didn't do it, but DF did. The first book that Diop wrote.
Yes, that's one of my favorites.
Civilization.
Yes,
what
sir.
What he says is that whence came the name Ham, Sham, Cam? Where could Moses have found it? Right in Egypt, where Moses was born, grew up, and lived until the Exodus. In fact, we know that the Egyptians called their country Kemet, which means black in their language. The interpretation according to which Kemet designates the black soil of Egypt, rather than black men, and by extension, the black race of the country, of the black stems from a gratuitous distortion by minds aware of what an exact interpretation of the word means. He says a gratuitous distortion by the minds.
Mm-hmm.
Asaim Hotep, he's trying to distort the actual history.
Well, we know we ain't gonna let you ain't gonna let nobody do that. You don't give a damn who it is. Dr. Klein's gonna call you out. The elder's gonna call you out. We gotta have an elder meeting here, okay?
The inhabitants of Egypt, I'm gonna continue. The inhabitants
Please.
Of Egypt symbolized by the black color Kemet. You know, we can see that the biblical curse of Ham, offspring had an origin quite different from the genetically given it today without the slightest historical foundation. What we cannot understand, however, is how it has been possible to make a white race a Kemet.
See? Wow.
And yet this brother, he can say that Diop didn't do it. He can say it. He's a hater. Ansar says that Diop didn't show his work. Here's another book by Diop. Parente genetic de la Egyptian pharaonic es des langues negro african. What are we seeing there?
Mm-hmm. Negro.
Egyptian mean Cam black. Cam mm-hmm. means black. The Negro.
Cam noir. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You
wait a minute now. You got wait a minute now, Clyde. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Did this guy piss you off a little bit? That's all I'm asking.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I think you're holding back a little bit. What's going on?
He's got a following that believe that Diop the master didn't do his homework.
Yeah, you're going to get called out on that shit.
I saw it. He knows about Kemet. Kemet means the green land, you damn lie.
Oof.
Here it is.
Tell us how you really feel about it, Doc.
Here
That's all I'm saying. Holding back a little bit.
Of ancient Egypt as the siphon of the mineral script. Anti-Diop, Obinga, they went up there. These at this place in UNESCO in Paris, France, they had every Egyptologist of the 1970s. And these two men are great savants, Diop and Obinga. They fought there. They told them that the Egyptians were black. What did he say? This is what they report. Professor Diop then turned his attention to the way in which the Egyptians described themselves. They used only one word for this purpose, Kemet, the strongest term existing in the language of the Pharaoh, of the pharaohs to indicate blackness, which was translated by Professor Diop as the Negroes. Consequently, this hieroglyph was not written with crocodile scales, but with a piece of charcoal. Professor Diop went into the question of compound words based on the word Kemet. The Egyptians distinguished themselves from other people by calling themselves Kemetru, Kemetru, Kemetru. But they did not draw a distinction on the basis of the color between themselves and the Nubians. Lastly, black was an adjective applied to the principal Egyptian deities, Osiris, Apis, Min, Thoth, Isis, Set.
Come on, come on.
How can this hater say that the master didn't teach?
Wow.
But every Saturday, you see this guy attacking anti-Diop. You see this guy talking about that Kemet don't mean black. And he says that Diop didn't do the work. Diop did the work.
My.
Is there more?
Oh, yeah. Oh, more.
Go to the General History of Africa, Volume 2. Here he explains that Kemet means black. What did he say? He says that in all of Egypt, it is in no waste of time to get the views of those principally concerned. How did the ancient Egyptians see themselves? Into which ethnic category did they put themselves? What did they call themselves? The language literature left to us by the Egyptians of the Pharaonic epoch supply explicit answers to these questions, which the scholars cannot refrain from minimizing, twisting, or interpreting. The Egyptians had only one term to designate themselves, Kemet, the blacks. This is the strongest term existing in the Pharaonic tongue, a length of wood, charred at the end, and not crocodile scales. This word is the ethnological origin of the well-known root Kemet, which has proliferated in modern anthropological literature. The biblical root Cam. How can you people who listen to this Asim Hotep every Saturday are you so stupid? You're not even looking at the damn book.
So hold on. Let me put something up on the screen. Let me put this up on the screen for you, Doc. Hold on. Because I'm not quite sure. This is probably one of the persons who is a proponent of Asar Imhotep. Somebody named Black. I think he may be referring to the fact that there were no sources, endnotes, footnotes in those pages you just showed. Don't block me. I'm just making an observation. What do you want? What do you think we should do, fam? And you know, underdog. Says that's a hater. LOL. I don't know what to do here. This is the first time we've been a.
Don't block him. I got more.
I don't.
He says you got no footnotes. He says no footnotes. Like here, here's the damn man. Here's the man. I'm gonna continue. In the Egyptian language, a word of assembly is formed from an adjective or noun, singular. Kemet from the adjective.
Thank you, Black, for showing up and staying in there, man. Hold on. Let's see what happens at the end of this.
It therefore means Christian Negroes, or at the very least, black men, dummies. That dummy, he's looking for a footnote. Read the damn books. Do your research. But I know you're so much, because all Anti-Imhotep says is, don't listen to the elders, listen to me. Yeah, you follow that fool.
All right, family. Well, that's the last of the first frequency of One in Shock Metaphysics show. I really appreciate all of you. I'm sure are going to be canceled on YouTube
furthermore, now. Furthermore, the language offers us another term, Kemetru, the Negroes, the black men, literally, Egyptians, as opposed to foreigners. The Kemetru! Get out of here. But why? 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 You see, these people, like Anti-Imhotep and the rest of these people, they believe in a sense that we're talking about the white man and then the black people as opposed. No, we're not. The ancient Egyptians didn't know about no damn white folks. They didn't care about no white folks.
Nope.
See,
they didn't exist.
If they read the damn Bible, they know that God created the first man, Adam, and he was black, brown. Look at the Bible dictionary. The Quran said Adam, woo, woo, woo. Get out of here. It ain't a cow clack. The black earth. But listen to this. Now, right here, here's a page. Here's a page from the history of, you see the footnotes? Tell that young man, here's the footnotes. Here's the footnotes.
Do here's not.
It was footnotes on the other pages I just didn't show them.
But do not mess with Clyde Winters. That's all I'm saying. Do not do that. Don't do it. It's not healthy. It's not mentally. It's not mentally healthy. Because he's going to come back and he's going to wear your ass out with evidence. Okay, keep going, Doc.
That the Egyptians, they called they called themselves black because they were all nothing but divine epithets. Finally, black and Negroes is the divine epithet invariably used for the chief beneficent gods of Egypt. Yes, yes! The beneficent gods of Egypt were all described as black. Black, black, be one, baby.
Come on, Clyde.
All the male violent spirits are qualified as Deseret Red. What are the surnames of the god? Kamru. Kamru. Who is Kamru? That's the great god, Osiris. Osiris. Stop using his name. Asar, you damn liar. You damn liar, liar, pass on fire.
Okay. Well, we know what's going to upset Doc. We know what Pop when you say some stuff about Diop and not being black, you're going to get reprimanded.
The qualificative is applied to Hathor, Apis, Men, Thoth. Stop it. Stop it. How could you foolish people believe that the Egyptians, that Diop did do his homework, you dummies? This dummy. You know what he even said last week? Wasn't a linguist.
Really?
Diop wasn't a linguist. He said he's a linguist. Hasem Hotep said he's a linguist, but Diop wasn't a linguist, dummies.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I can't. Okay. That's what that. Okay, go ahead. Keep talking. Go ahead. Why would you?
Followers, not to listen to elders.
You're making this dude famous on my platform. What the hell's going on?
Because he is weak and looking for acceptance by whites. Yes. Lie. Liar, liar, pants on fire. He's two-faced. He's two-faced. Now here is this. I didn't come to you talking out of my butt. I talked to you. I showed you my receipts. I showed you what the great master teacher, Anti-Diop, said about Kemet. And if you still want to believe Asar, there's nothing wrong with it. You know what they say, ignorance is bliss. But my mama said, find a fool and bump his dumb head.
What heritages are shared by Dalits and FBA? Because that's what this actually is supposed to be about. Talk to us about that.
Yes, sirs. But the thing is that we need to understand why you want to be called black. I'm tired of these people thinking that black is only because we live around white people. Mm-hmm. And that's why being B1 has nothing to do with being around white people. Mm-hmm. You're B1 because black was first. That's why you call us first frequency.
Mm-hmm.
Black was first.
Facts.
And so if black was first, it doesn't matter about them. The Egyptians didn't have no white folks around them, but they called themselves black.
Mm-hmm.
The Assyrians, mm-hmm. they called themselves black. The Sumerians called themselves black. That's a secret. That's a secret. You have a genetic memory. If you go to that mm-hmm. genetic memory and you talking about something else besides being black, you're not going to even be able to go to the library.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, the genetic memory has a library, but in that library, everything is classified as black.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So if you don't believe mm-hmm. you're black, if you believe you're moral,
you are lost. You are literally lost.
You're lost. You're lost. Yep. You're lost.
Yep.
Your ancestors not gonna touch you. Who that mm-hmm. fool? Who that fool?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Your ancestors aren't gonna touch you. You're Say not it. Gonna find the knowledge. See, but what gets me is, why are you gonna believe somebody who tells you that one of your master's teachers didn't do his homework? I don't understand. How could you believe that?
Yep.
How could you believe that?
Yep, absolutely.
Egypt Dollars, foundational Black Americans. Two principal minorities in the United States and India are foundational Black Americans and the Dalits, formerly known as the Untouchables of India. W.B. Du Bois in the World in Africa, and World in Africa, and V.D. Rajeshkar in Dalits, the Black Untouchables of India, and the Dalit Bishop Reverend Azaria have linked African Americans and East Indians to an African origin. Yes. Yes. Although these minorities are separated by thousands of miles, both ethnic groups locate their origins in Africa and see Egyptian civilization as part of their ethnic heritage. This idea of an Egyptian heritage is part of the liberation history curriculum taught in their schools. Mm-hmm. In India, there's four castes. There's the Brahmin, the Kshatriya, the Vaishya, Pavashya, the Shudra, and the Dalits. You know, it is so sad. You know, in India, you can kill a Dalit and you face no justice.
Mm.
You're a Dalit or a Muslim and you're killed by a Hindu, you will not even be arrested.
So they have the casual killing act in there as well. Interesting.
Yes, because see, the leader of India now, Modi, he's what's called, he belongs to the Hindutva. The Hindutva. The Hindutva is another name for Hindu nationalists.
Mm.
But they believe in a sense is that they should rule the country because they part white. Yeah, look black to me a lot of them.
Mm-hmm.
Although mm-hmm. these minorities are separated by thousands of miles, both ethnic groups locate their origins in Africa and see Egyptian civilization as part of their ethnic heritage. This idea of an Egyptian heritage is part of the liberation history curriculum taught in their school. Now you understand. The reason I had to talk about Egypt being black is I had to, in a sense, make you understand why black people over here, foundational black Americans, and why Dalits also see Egypt as their father, as mm-hmm. their motherland, because mm-hmm. they know that we were black. So when you got somebody going around teaching these ignorant people who don't even want to read a book,
mm-hmm.
that the mm-hmm. master teacher is teaching a lie, and when the master teacher says that Kamen means black, he's lying, you have to set them straight, because we want people to know the history.
Facts. So what role does Egypt or Kemet play in FBA, foundational Black Americans' identities?
That's a good question. Afro-Americans have been deeply interested in the study of ancient world history and the role of Blacks in this history. Many Afro-Americans believe that writing ancient history is a political act. Yes, writing history is a political act. Carter G. Woodson in The Miseducation of the Negro observed, and I quote, "The oppressor, play up before the Negro, then his crimes and shortcomings. Let him learn to admire the Hebrew, the Greeks, the Latin, and the Teuton. Lead the Negro to detest the man of African blood, to hate himself." Hate himself every night. Every night you can look at ABC, CBS, NBC. If it's a local news channel, every night they got somebody on there black that's supposed to committed a crime.
Mm-hmm.
Carter G. Woodson, mm-hmm. he wrote this back in the 1920s, the mm-hmm. 1930s. But he's mm-hmm. telling you the program. He's telling you the script. They don't put that on TV for nothing. They put it on TV to make you feel ashamed, to make you feel you're a loser, to make you want to give up, to make you fail. There's no hope. These scholars see the writing of ancient Black history as an antidote to white supremacy. Yes, 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 yes. I come on Reverend Shock show, Reverend Shock platform, to let you know that you can fight white supremacy worldwide by knowing who you are.
Facts.
Mm-hmm. Somebody said ancient history can teach you nothing, because ancient history can only teach you about the past. Damn straight. But when you learn about the past, that tells you what you're capable of. That tells you what you can do. See?
Mm-hmm.
When you hear about Black people flying to the moon during the time of Ramses I, then you understand how that brother in Africa who made it so you can see TV without electricity, it made you understand the wonderful things we can do.
Absolutely.
Anything that comes to your mind, you can do it. But you got to believe. And Carter G. Woodson is telling you, they don't want you to believe in yourself. They don't want you to know what you're capable of. They don't want you to know that Black is powerful. That's why people like Asarim Hotep is teaching you that there's no such thing as Black. The Egyptians wasn't Black. Egypt was the green land. No, Egypt was the Black land for Egypt.
I know this is upsetting you.
They call themselves Black. Everybody, please put in the chat. Be one. Put in the chat. Please. In the miseducation of the Negro road, he, second frequency, teaches the Negro that he has no worthwhile past, that his race has done nothing significant since the beginning of time, and there is no evidence that he will ever achieve anything great. The education of the Negro then must be carefully direct, at least the race may waste time trying to do the impossible right. Do you understand? I do not like attacking Asarim Hotep. The brother has done some interesting work on the Bantu linguistics. I give him credit for that. But I can't let nobody attack the master. I can't let
That's
nobody
right.
attack my daddy.
Yeah, you're bringing up a really powerful point. Let me bring you back on screen for a moment so we can have this quick little intersection or admission. We have to protect our scholars. We have to protect our elders, and we have to protect our ancestors. Our younger generation comes along and they want to make a name for themselves. And I understand. I was there. I understand it. I've done this too. It's an immaturity that comes from insecurity. Because you want to be right, you want to be popular, and in order to do that, you've got to be different. You bring up a very good point about the hip hop generation or the new hip hop generation, the current hip hop generation. It's about battle rap. So it's always about battling. And so in order to battle, you have to put somebody down to build yourself up. That's the European way. That's the second frequency way. And so that's what fourth frequency is doing. Which is why you're fourth frequency. I've done this, so I understand exactly what's going on. I have done it to my chagrin. I have done it, but that's the other thing. You don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater. Some of the work is phenomenal, but you cannot talk about the elders, the ancients who gave us our civilization and our history back to us. That is not acceptable, and so. I get it. You know, the younger group, they don't want to listen to the old heads. You know, I'm considered an old head now, and I get it. But family, there is a decorum that we have in first frequency, and there's just certain rules that I wanted to reestablish and to not talk about necessarily, but just show it. I want to show people who love us. I want to show people and scholars who love us and are willing to fight for us. That's the problem. So many of us just sit back and let everybody crap on us, including us. Yes. And nobody says anything.
That's
Clyde comes on and says, no, I'm not going to allow that. You can have your scholarship, right, wrong, whatever. You can believe in black, white, green, purple, or whatever, but you will not disrespect an ancestral elder. You will not do that. That's not what we do. So you, if you don't agree with the man, find another way, but you do not go public and say anything bad. It's like all of our scholars today. You're not supposed to go on and say anything negative about anybody. And I got this from Kaba. Anybody who's doing anything for black people, you do not have the right to hurt them, harm them, or shun them. You just need to shut the hell up and be one. And so I'm just going to leave it at that, beloved. Do what you will, fam. But I'm trying to gather and gain a different type of audience. I do not want to be popular. I want to be correct. And in order to be correct, that means I have to have content. I have to have scholars and scholarship that might cut against the grain of the third and fourth frequency mindset and mentality. The go along, the get along, and just the plain angry and ignorant. I've been all of those. I've been all of those. And that's why I understand the power of first frequency. But I also understand the importance of corrective history and corrective knowledge. That's why Clyde is on this platform every week, because he is correcting it. He is giving us the research and teaching us how to do it. That's a whole nother conversation. He's teaching us how to do what he's done and what he is doing, right? So that's how I can cooperate. No, this guy is not full of ish, is because I can go to any presentation that Clyde has done, any book that Clyde has written, any PowerPoint that he has done, any PDF that he has done, and I can find all of the sources. I can go back and reverse engineer. I can backtrack to see if this guy knows what the hell he's talking about. Well, fam, Clyde knows what he is talking about. He's got the receipts. So if it rubs you the wrong way, it's not intentional to harm you in any kind of way. This is about mental health. This is what tough love looks like sometimes, or first frequency love looks like sometimes, when you're correcting misappropriated behavior. Go ahead, Doc. Finish your piece.
You got to understand this, people out there. You got to understand this. If there's a black person who pretends that he's a scholar, who pretends that he's a linguist, and then he attacks the master teacher,
yeah,
then he's leaving you with no hope.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
He's telling you that whatever the second frequency said negative about our master teachers, we should accept.
Mm-hmm.
You can't do that.
Mm-hmm.
See,
mm-hmm.
Dion mm-hmm. was saying be one. Yes, he had a white wife, but he was saying be one. He always mm-hmm. said be one, be mm-hmm. one. And then to have somebody say that Kermit don't mean black and don't mean black people. Stop. Stop.
Mm-hmm.
That's why the Dalits. That's why we look towards Egypt. And when we look towards Egypt, we look towards Egypt based mainly on the research of who? Antar Diop.
Mm-hmm.
Antar Diop. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. when you find a faker, a hater, a liar, pants on fire, attacking the master, you gotta say something.
I love it. I love it. I love it. All right. So here's the question. When did the Dalits and the FBA first come into contact with one another?
That's a good question. The Atlantic slave trade played an important role in how Afro-Americans viewed the development of their history curriculum. This historical experience led to the African Holocaust, in which Du Bois claims 100 million blacks, yes, 100 million blacks, died crossing the Atlantic Ocean during the Middle Passage or on slave plantations throughout the Americas. I hear a lot of these brothers, they're talking about the fact, how could they bring millions of black old people over here in a boat? How did millions of white people come over here on a boat? It's so stupid. If millions of white people came over here on a boat, why couldn't millions of slaves come over here on a boat? I don't understand it. I don't understand. Maybe I'm just getting older or something.
No, I don't think so.
They taught me how to think. If millions can come on the boat, why can't the other folk come on the boat? The African origin of the Afro-Americans led to the desire among many members of this population, an understanding about their African homeland, Mama Africa. They also want to know about the history of their people in the United States. Some of these Indian slaves were Lascars. Lascars. Indian sellers of the Dutch East Indian Company, while other slaves were captured in slave raids in India and sold into chattel slavery. Many people don't understand the American slave trader was slick. The American slave trader, he knew that all the centers on the West Coast was ran by Europeans, the Portuguese, the British. So the American slavers, they went around to East Africa. Many of the American slavers, they took slaves from Mozambique, Zanzibar, and India. Yes, India.
Wow, I had no idea.
You know, I think even some of you guys who've had your your DNA tests. A lot of times they say people came from Southeast Africa or East Africa, you know, and it's you know, because of the fact that they brought a lot of slaves from Mozambique. These Europeans brought these slaves from over there. The first East Indian slaves were situated in Jamestown, Virginia. In 1622, there's a report of an East Indian slave, a servant of Captain George Menifee. Wonawaya, both the 20th of May, lost an East Indian India named Thomas Greenwich. He is a well-made fellow, about 5'4" high, wears his own hair, which is long and black, has a thin visage, a very fly look, and a remarkable set of fine white teeth. They love to see our teeth. A reward of 20 shillings will be paid the person who delivers him to the subscriber, besides what the law allows. William Colston. Yes, yes, yes. Look at this.
Now, I also want to say something. To go back to that slide, beloved, if you could. Go back to that slide. Hold on a second. So you see, go back to the, yep, that's it. So I learned this also from Dr. Jacqueline Battalora. So there's the anti-miscegenation laws that Dr. Jacqueline Battalora spoke about for about 3 years on our platform can be found in what's known as the Burgess Archives. And one of the things that she said, so you can literally read the laws. Like when I tell you about, you know, white people being invented in 1681, the three laws that came down, when I do that spiel, when I do that piece, that's what we're pulling from. It's a law book. These are laws written in Virginia and in colonial times. But I want to make sure that people understand. She told me that the F was an S. So if you go and look at some of the writings, the F, which it says for scriber, is actually pronounced S. And I don't know when they changed that, but I just wanted to make a point, since we're talking about linguistics, that the F is an actual S. And so that's why that is there. But it's also found in the original Virginia laws. I forgot, I think it's about, I don't know how many of those books. It's a lot, it's a long read. They're about 500 pages each. You really gotta want it, but that's where you can go to get it. Go ahead, Doc. I just want to clarify that.
I also had to remind you, just as Doc brought this up, I want to remind you that when we talk about Virginia, when they're talking about Virginia, Virginia back in those days included North Carolina, South Carolina, and Georgia. Yeah. Mm. All of that was considered Virginia back in the day. Richmond County 6, February 1705-1706, petition of Simbo, an East India Indian servant to General Lloyd Esquire for his freedom. Petition of Muda, an East India Indian servant to Captain Thomas Beale, surviving executor of Mr. William Colston, deceased, for his freedom. Ordered a judge that said, Muda be free. Ordered a judge that said, Simbo be free. Simbo, Simbo. You know, when I was up, when I was young, when I went to university, I was really shocked because I found an Indian book about old black Sambo. In the Indian book, they said that Sambo came from Africa. But in the African book, it said that Sambo came from India. You see, what did Edie Fuller say? The white supremacists play both sides. But as you can see, there were Indian slaves. There were Indian slaves in the 1600s, and there were still Indian slaves from India here in the 1700s.
Wow. Wow. Great history
lesson. County, March 1708, Will, an East India Indian, late a supposed slave to Mr. Daniel Neal by his petition to this court, setting forth that sometime in the year 1689, being fraudulently trapped and out of his native country in the East Indies, and thence transported to England, and soon after brought into this country and sold as a slave to Mr. Christopher Neal, deceased father of his said present master. Listen to this. Listen to this. Just like they kidnapped black people in Africa, they kidnapped black people in India. That's why Neely Fuller tells you we are prisoners of war. We're prisoners of war because we were stolen. Those black Indians, they stole them from their black Indian villages. Nobody volunteered for slavery.
Ain't that the truth? Say that.
And that he had ever since faithfully served the said Christopher and Daniel, notwithstanding which the said Daniel, though often demanded, denied him his freedom. And the said Daniel, being summoned to answer the said complaint, appeared, and both parties submitted the whole matter of the complaint to the court, all which being maturely and fully heard, it is considered by the court that the said Will ought not to have been sold as a slave, and that he is a freeman. Yes, these people gained their freedom, but how many of those people from India didn't get freedom?
Wow. Wow, this is good, Doc. So how did Kemet become part of the foundation of Black African history curriculum?
This is a great question. After slavery, Afro-Americans began to write history and establish their own history curriculum. This curriculum was based on the ancient model of history. The ancient model of history was based on references to Africans and Black people in the classical literature and the Bible. Yes, yes, yes. You know, the white man today, he teaches you that those books written by the Greeks and Romans, that they're just mythology. You know why he say it's mythology? He says it's mythology because they say Black people had civilizations. And they don't want you to know that Black people had civilizations. They want you to feel that we was always waiting on the beach, getting a suntan with a mint julep, waiting for them to come and capture us and bring us over to America to work on the plantation for free. They made us work for free. Give me my check. In the 19th century, Afro-Americans began to write textbooks. Use segregated Afro-American schools, which included material about the history of Blacks in Africa and the ancient world, especially Egypt. This is what you had to understand. If you remember after slavery, all these Black people left the plantation. They didn't give us a damn dollar. They didn't give us a nickel. They didn't give us no land. But we still formed our own schools. We formed our own schools. We taught our own people. And we wrote our own history. We didn't wait for second frequency to write our history. We didn't wait until second frequency to tell us who we were. We sought our own freedom.
That's right.
It was in these books that the paradigms associated with the ancient model and Afro-American study of ancient history, ASAH. ASAH means Afro-American study of ancient history, were confirmed and given reliability by empirical research. Imperial research. whose mm-hmm. these texts would provide the pedagogic vehicles for the perpetuation of the ecological normal social science. Empirical research.
Mm.
We got a group of people right now in my class.
Mm-hmm.
I call them the Dirty 30.
I call them the
Dirty 30.
That's true. Yes, indeed, I do. It's 30 of us, man. We badass up in there, man.
And don't get me stuttering. These guys are gonna rock this world, baby.
Listen to me. Listen to me.
You're gonna see articles. You're gonna see more research than you ever thought could happen.
Listen to me. You are about to see a beast unleashed onto the scene of Africana phenomenology and the disciplines of anthropology and archaeology, linguistics. I mean, the folks in this class, like Go Travel Abroad is one of them, Sister Sean Baquette. Listen, this y'all don't understand. We literally are the Bernie Macs, about to be the Bernie Macs of scholarship, because we ain't scared of you MFs. We didn't come here for no foolishness, and we're about to whoop that ass. Because what we realize is we've realized what's missing, right? So then the question was asked, which is why this whole thing started. Doc, how can we do primary research? How can we get to the core? How do we know what it is that we're reading? How can we look at a piece of paper or a book or whatever, or an article? How can we define it? How can we dissect it? How do we know what's true and what's not? That's what we're learning how to do. Now, we also know what's the structure of writing a paper. How do you review a paper? And I'm now, interestingly enough, so I told y'all I submitted my dissertation. It came back. I had to make some updates on the citations because they use MLA citations versus APA. I had to do that. I got an email from my dissertation person. I took a word out or something. They just asked me if I could put that back in or whatever. So even before this level of research came into place, I'm doing the research, but now I know how to write it. I know how to format it. I know how to go and what, Doc, if you look at some of the earlier shows with Dr. Winters, he used a term called falsificationist. And I'm going to ask you to explain what that is again for the family. But now this Dirty 30 we are going to outright outpublish any scholar that is in existence currently and any scholar past in our ancestry history. This is a new day. This is a whole new group and crop of the top researchers in the world. And they're all over the world because we've got researchers, people in this class are in the UK, people in this class are from here and all around the world. And we're getting ready. I'm a willing, knock on wood, as Clyde said, it's always my fault. Knock on wood, if it's my fault, thanks a lot, Clyde, thanks a lot. Then Clyde's decided to do one just exclusively for the UK. So the United Kingdom, get ready. But Dr. Clyde Winters is going to be offering his research class exclusively to the United Kingdom group and audience so that they know how to be foundational Black Britons. And we're going to have a special guest with that process, Dr. Marie Charles, who's going to be with us next week. I ain't playing with nobody, man. I know what we need to do, and I'm cutting out all the bullshit, all the nonsense, all the debating, all the bickering back and forth. We're just coming with the scholarship, and we're bringing the receipts with us. Go ahead, Doc.
Our elevation, Martin Delaney, okay, falsificationists mean that you have a question and you have an hypothesis. And what you do is that you confirm, for example, what did I do today? Today, I talked about Assar Imhotep. Assar Imhotep, he said that Diop did not do the work. So what I did is I tried to falsify. I tried to show that Assar Imhotep was not correct. So I had to use abundance of evidence. So I showed that Antiochus used four books to, to tell us that Kemet means black, not not green land. You see, that was falsification.
Reba asked me to remove the troll. I removed the troll. If there's any other trolls families that you see, shout them out and I will block them.
Yeah. And so falsification is just using an abundance of evidence, an abundance of evidence to prove a point. Martin Delaney said, our elevation must be the result of self-efforts and work of our own hands. No other human power can accomplish it. If we can, if we but determine it shall be so, it will be. Say that again. Martin Delaney said, our elevation must be the result of our self-efforts and work of our own hands. I mean, we got to do this work.
That's right. That's right.
No other human power can accomplish it. If we but determine, it shall be so. In other words, if we just try it, it's got to be so. In the Old Testament, the blacks are recognized as the sons of Ham. According to the Old Testament narrative found in the book of Genesis, the children of Ham are alleged to be the founders of all the ancient civilizations, including Cush, the Tarseti and the Sea Group cultures of Nubia and the Sudan, the Sumerians of Mesopotamia, and the Elamites of Iran, Mizraim, the founder of the Egyptians, Punt, the civilization of ancient Ethiopia, South Arabia, and Canaan, the early Canaanites and Hadians of ancient Palestine. Yes, yes, yes. That Bible. That Bible. Second Frequency gave that Bible to us to pacify us, to look towards Jesus as our Lord and Savior. And there's nothing wrong with seeing Jesus as your Lord and Savior. But Second Frequency made a mistake because we also read the Old Testament. He didn't know the King James Version got the Old Testament and the New Testament. The Old Testament said we were the sons of Ham. That's what they told you on the plantation. You the sons of Ham. You were here to be our slaves. But when we read that Bible, we found that the children of Ham built Cush, built Egypt, built Punt, built Canaan. Know your history. By the late 19th century, Afro-American researchers began to write textbooks on Afro-American history. In these textbooks, Afro-American educators not only discussed the history of Africans in the USA and Africa, they also discussed the ancient civilization founded by blacks in Egypt and Mesopotamia. The pedagogy for ancient Africological research was well established by the end of the 19th century by African-American researchers, well versed in the classical languages and knowledge of Greek and Latin. According to work in 1827.
My.
Not 1927. And we almost, 2027. That means that we've been writing our history for 200 years. 200 years. We're not new jacks. Cornish and Rustrum in the Freedom Journal were the first African Americans to discuss and explain the ancient model of history, the fact that we had a history, that we are history. By 1883, Africological research began to publish books on African-American history. G.W. Williams wrote the first textbook on African-American history in 1883 in the history of the Negro race in America. Dr. Williams provided the schema for all future Africological history texts. This ain't no new deal. Most people think, oh, black people just started talking about their history. Damn lie. We've been talking about our history for 200 years, and every time we talk about it, we make it shine. We make it glow. Be what? Pauline E. Hopkins added further articulation to the ASH.
Love it.
To the application of these paradigms and understanding the role of blacks in Egypt. Hopkins provided further confirmation of the role of blacks in Southeast Asia and expanded the scope of Africological research. Here's some Hadians. The authors of the Africological textbooks report the latest archaeological and anthropological findings. They always tell you, oh, these black people always talking about old literature. That's because when they wrote their books in the 1920s, 50s, 1940s, they used the latest archaeological research. Mm-hmm. It's not old text. That was the latest research in their time. And that's what I've been spending my time doing, is to show that what they talked about 100 years ago, 50 years ago, 30 years ago, we know more about today. Look here, mm-hmm. here we got some Hodians. Look at these Hodians. Look at those afros. Damn, I used to have an afro till I got bald. I'm jealous.
Poor thing. You can't grow facial hair. Oh no. You don't want one of these though, because I don't know this damn thing. I don't know how the hell this thing grows the way it grows. I just, you know, it's like, it's easy to pick me out of a goddamn lineup. That's all I'm saying. I can't be incognito to save my damn life with this damn thing.
Okay, I'm gonna stop being jealous.
You got, hold on, Derek. I love this, Derek Livingston. He says, "I thought Doc said he was a little tired today." No, you're not. Don't lie. Don't lie. You start talking about Diop, you woke the F up, is what you did. That's.
I've been up since 2:30 a.m. Let me tell you a story. When I was teaching, you know, one of my colleagues, you know, Miss Poindexter, one day she said, "Dr. Winters, I can't sleep all night." I said, "How old are you?" She said, 52. I said, "That's the problem. When you start getting your 50s, you just can't sleep all night."
No, you can't. I know. That's a fact.
Sometimes
that's a fact.
You go back to sleep and all that type of stuff. Sometimes you just can't sleep all night. They say you don't need all sleep, but you do need that sleep.
You do need it, but it's like, how do I get it? Because my body is, I was just having a conversation earlier today with Dr. Guy Gentil. He's one of our greatest clinical psychologists and clinical minds, a proponent of Dr. Wade Nobles. And he developed a meditation for insomniacs, because he's an insomniac and he's in the same age group. It's not just the insomnia. It's also what's known as the rumination. It's like your mind. Like when I get quiet at night and lay in the bed, Amma and the ancestors wear me out. All kinds of ideas, all kinds of conversations with the universe starts. And the next thing I know, it's daylight outside. I'm like, what the hell just happened? Go ahead, Doc.
And what makes it so bad, you got to write it down. If you don't write
yes.
it down, you know.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. Otherwise, you lose it.
Yeah. You know, yep. but you know, I slept better when my baby dad was here, but that's another story.
That's another story.
The discovery of artifacts on the ancient sites depicting Black African people proved that the classical and Old Testament literature, as opposed to the Aryan model, objectively identified the Black African role in ancient history. W.E.B. Du Bois is all considered a content specialist when writing the Afro-American history curriculum. His major contributions to this area were The Negro and The World in Africa. In these books, Egypt's African heritage was explained and discussed in detail. You have to understand that when you find a Black person denying that the Egyptians called themselves Black, this guy is an enemy. She is an enemy. Because, see, the Egyptians called themselves Black because, see, remember, the first nome, the first state in Egypt was Tassete. And the Tassete used to call themselves Nahise or Cushites, but they stopped that shit. They said, "We're forming Egypt." And then when he formed Egypt, they had all these different Black people from different tribes, but they didn't want to call themselves Wolof. They didn't want to call themselves Mandé. They didn't want to call themselves, you know, Akkad. They said, "We got to stop this mess. We one people. We Black people. We be one." Mm-hmm. One. So when you find somebody saying that the Egyptians didn't call themselves Black, they're trying to tell you to be divided.
Mm-hmm.
They're trying to tell you to be separated. And how did second frequency take over Africa? How did second frequency take over America? He took over because those black people were tribalistic. They all wanted to be separate. Instead of saying be one, be one, be one. Lewis Hanbury was primarily interested in classical references to blacks in Egypt and elsewhere. It is the classical literature which linked Africans and East Indians. In many parts of the United States, up until the segregation of American schools in 1954, black people attended schools which were segregated, yes. Up until 1954, except in the North, most black people went to schools with other black people. We had to get our own books. And these schools, Afro-American school administrators used a history curriculum that included Afro-American and African history. And these texts, the history of Egypt, was included. Yes, yes. That's why I advise some of you people, if you're out of time, sometime listen to Dr. Greg Carr when he's talking about the history of foundational Black Americans. Granted, most of that history is an elitist history. It's about the kids and their children and all that. But at the same time, you learn about our history. You learn about how we got together. You learn how we fought. Where we came from.
Facts. All facts.
Up until the 1950s, the most popular Afro-American history text used in public Afro-American schools was The Negro in Our History. The Negro in Our History was written by Carter G. Woodson. Carter G. Woodson founded the Journal of Negro History. This book discussed Egypt as a Black African nation. Yes, yes. Egypt is a Black African nation. When you got a brother, when you got a sister, saying that the Egyptians weren't Black, they said nothing more than what the white man say. They're an enemy.
Fantastic. Okay. So when did the Dalits place Kemet in their history curriculum? That's a powerful question.
It all began in 1985, the Dalits, I contacted them and I began to write about their history. I talked about the African origin of the glorious Dalits. You see, this excited the Dalits throughout India. The Dalits throughout India finally knew where they came from, finally understood, had hope for a better future, you see. You can read more about the ancient Dravidians in my book, The Dravidian Connection. There are $160 million in India. They
share. Hold on a second, Doc. Hold on a second. I got a couple of things that needs to be taken care of. One, I'm not sure. Mateo, FBA, stop your nonsense. Uncle Phil, African Diaspora Network Channel. Have white Hispanic wife like Childish Gambino, but capitalizing on black views and grassroots while he invests white in bed. Mateo, are you talking about me or are you talking about somebody else? Because I have a black wife. So I just want to be clear about that. So please let me know what you mean by that. Because if you're talking about me, I'm about to block the shit out of you. Now, the other person, I need to come on here and call out. Hold on. Let's see where. Okay. So Professor C, I don't know who she is, but she says, can we stop using the term black? Now, you know, for the, I don't know, last two goddamn hours, you have been talking about this. So I don't want to block these people, but it's so goddamn frustrating. It's ridiculous, man. I'm like, what's wrong with you people? Go to a... Oh, African Diaspora Channel. Oh, okay. Another man. Okay. Okay, Vicky Dillard. Man from Vicky Dillard. Okay. Thank you, Mateo. I was worried, brother. I didn't know. I was like, I ain't got no wife. I got no white wife. What the hell? Okay, so, sister, I love you, and I don't know you, but I love you in First Frequency of Oneness. What's her name? Professor C. But this is the wrong channel for you, my goddess. I wish you the absolute best. Go ahead and do what you got to do. Okay, yeah. That's blocked. Go ahead, Doc. Continue, please. Thank you, family. Keep me honest. Let's go.
I'm gonna get back on the dollars, but now you just heard me. I brought receipts. I showed the book.
Totally.
Where Diop said Black is the legitimate name for the Egyptians, and yet that woman said that.
It's a sickness. It's a sickness. Some people you can't save. You can't help them.
You can't save. You can't help them. But why are they here?
Right. Exactly. Right. Exactly.
Why are they here? I know some of them are white because I've seen some of the trolls. Because after the show, I go and look at the because I can see some of the trolls, some of the stuff they're talking about. But the thing is that I bring my receipts.
Yep.
I bring my receipts
every day, every time you're on here, every time.
I don't come here with that mess. And the whole point is that Diop had a white wife. It didn't stop him from being Black first.
That's right.
He wasn't like most of these Black
time guys. Also, I have to admit, time was a lot different then than it is now. Now, today, he might not be able to get away with them shits. But back in the day, yep, that's fine. And he's in a foreign country, in a different country. So there are some other things that we could look at around that. But yeah, you're absolutely right. Nobody has done a contribution more than Diop. And I would probably say that was a divide and conquer strategy, because one of the things we've learned in our ministry is what we call, of course, now I'm drawing a blank because I'm trying to think about it. But I had Dr. Matthew Knowles on, who is the father of Beyonce and Solange. And I've had him on a few times. Good guy. Talk to him on a regular basis. Beautiful brother. But he went through this third frequency thing where he was just smashing white women all the time. And the reason why he chose his wife was so light because he just wanted to be in that white. When he went through therapy, watch this now. When he went through therapy, the first round of therapists that he went through were all white and perhaps even Jewish. They only took him so far. They kept him in a loop. And he said, there are certain issues I'm having that a white psychologist can't help me with. So he found a Black psychologist, and that Black psychologist explained to him what was happening and why a lot of Black men, particularly those of means or those are entertainment and athletes, why do they smash or are attracted to so many white women? The term is called eroticized rage. Eroticized rage is the science behind getting back at the white man by taking his most prized possession, and that is his white woman. Now, some of this is conscious and deliberately done, but for the most part, you got to have some frequency to be able to decode it. But for the most part, these brothers who are attracted to white women and have a bunch of white women, it's revenge relationship. It's revenge sex. It's not love. And I asked Dr. Knowles about, I said, did you love these women? He's like, not one bit. It was strictly, it was a reverse divide and conquer strategy, which I thought was fascinating. But go ahead, Doc. What is your thoughts on that?
It's a little bit more complicated today because a lot of them go to school. They've been going to school when they were kids. But when I went to University of Illinois, the first thing I did, I was walking to Illinois. I lived in Illinois Street Residence. I was going over to the residence hall across the cornfield, and I found about five or six white people screwing in the cornfield. When you go into the rec room in front of everybody, white people would be screwing in the rec room under a blanket. I found that many brothers didn't have game. Brothers who didn't have game either joined a fraternity or they got a white girl, because see, a white girl, it was easy for them to give up that sex. So a lot of brothers went with white girls because it was easy to talk to them, and they gave up sex real easy. A sister, no matter what they talk about, sisters being promiscuous, you had to really
have
some game. Yeah.
That's not true.
Game. But then those white girls, they would give up sex easy. So again, I'm not trying to denigrate anybody. But
no, it's a fact. I mean, that's part of the study of what we're doing in history. We're looking at the behaviors, characteristics, traits, and behaviors. That's what we're looking at.
And like I said last night to Shanice, she said that white women are the symbol of womanhood. I said, no, the symbol of womanhood is the black woman as the mother goddess.
That's right.
I said, white women are the symbol of the sexual person.
That's white right.
Women, white women are a symbol of you can have sex. They're just sexual.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing mm-hmm. that says that they got the mind. It's the black woman who has the mind, who has the wisdom, who has the knowledge.
And don't forget, she's sexy too. Shit, my black women, man, was you. My black women are fine as hell, dog. I'm just letting you know. See, I can't do it. I cannot mess around outside of my race. I don't even look at white women in that way. Because ain't nothing sexier, sweeter, and softer than my precious Yolanda. That's true. I know. I'm just saying. Hey, man.
Come back, baby.
I know, right? You will never see me. You'll see me with a lot of shit, but you ain't gonna see me with a white bitch. That's all I'm saying. Now let's move on. Let's go ahead on now and continue on. I'm sorry, man. I'm trying to straighten out my act and be a little cleaner. Go ahead, Doc.
As I tell these people, it's your fault. There are $160 million in India. They share with Afro-Americans a history of segregation and slavery. In the past, dollars were called outcasts or untouchables. Mohandas Gandhi called them Harijans, children of the street. The term dollar means crushed and broken. Look at that. They call these black people crushed and broken because they got a right to kill them. Many dollars live on the street. Many dollars live on the street their entire lives. Can you imagine that?
You're unbelievable.
You're living on the damn street. Your kids being born on the street.
Mm.
See, this is just how evil these people are.
Mm-hmm.
They call mm-hmm. themselves Indo-Aryans because mm. they consider themselves to be white. Even though many of them aren't white, but they got a white mentality. Their mind is second frequency.
Mm-hmm.
All they
mm-hmm.
see is first.
This reminds me of the black Brits that you talked about that sold us out, the third frequency. That was this is the same thing.
That's right.
That's happening right now in real time, modern day.
They didn't see it. You see? They didn't see it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The dollar history curriculum is founded on the research linking Dravidian speakers to Africa. The archaeological and genetic evidence suggests that the Dravidians may have originated in Africa. And you can see this book, Sergeant B. Genesse de l'India. Okay, it's in French, but the whole point is just buy my books on the Dravidians. They're in English. You know,
nice.
FBA research is very insecure and jealous. Yes, we're very jealous. A lot of FBA researchers, they don't support each other. A lot of FBA researchers, they're right on your back. They're still your work.
Mm-hmm.
They will never give you credit. Mm-hmm. I used to reach out to other FBA researchers and even help them with their research. In return, they mm-hmm. take work and fail to cite your help.
Mm.
Back in 1980, I gave a lecture at Compton College in L.A. I gave Renoka Rashidi some of my research on blacks in Asia. He took the research, wrote a book, and has made a name for himself for over 30, 40, 50 years. And he never mentions where he got his stuff from.
Mm-hmm.
He never mentioned it. But let me read to you what the dollars say. This is in the dollars, the Black Untouchables in India. I quote, it all began with Claude Ahmed Winters, guest edition of the September 16, 1985. The African origin of the glorious Dalits. He reached out the eyes and he brought to the world the entire African-American population and brought them close to us.
Wow.
What was the result? What was the result? Renoka Rashidi came rushing to India and inaugurated the first all-India Dalit Writers Conference at Hyderabad. Yes, yes, yes!
Wow. How did that make you feel, beloved, that you have an Indian scholar literally put you in a book? in a preface to the third edition, and saying that just honoring your scholarship. That's amazing.
But I got even more than that.
Have you ever been to India?
I haven't ever been. I probably can't go to India.
You probably can't.
You know, true. Can't go to India, my books.
That's true.
My articles. My
books. You could go. You might not get back. That's the goddamn problem. But yes.
Thing is this. I just wanted to show people. When I tell you that I gave Renoka Rashidi stuff, people will think I'm lying. Right here, show right. This man right. has always been. This man has always been following me. Following me. But he'll yep. never admit where he got his shit from.
Right, right, right.
But Renoka Rashidi. He's a great friend of the Dalits. Renoka Rashidi, he inaugurated the first All India Dalit Writers Conference in Hyderabad, but he still never admit where he got his stuff from. These are the Dravidian people. Look at these beautiful people.
Wow. People
like, yo, a major Dalit leader was Viti Rajeshkar, except the African origin of the Dalits based on the classical literature, genetic, linguistic research. The link Dravidians and Africans. Yes! Let me tell you something. If you go this right now and you look up Tamil Sumerian studies, do you know who they're going to have right there on that first page?
Mm-hmm.
Ahmed Winters.
Mm-hmm.
I don't play.
No, you do not.
I'm here for all Black people to know where they came from, who we are. Who we are. We are mighty, mighty people.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Just because your hair is straight don't mean a damn thing. When I had hair, I could put grease in it. It was good. Anyway!
Oh, Lord. Oh, he's crazy.
Come back here.
Come on back, Clyde. Anyway. Come on back home.
And this is what Herodotus wrote. He said, the Eastern Ethiopians differ in nothing from the other Ethiopians, save in their language and the character of their hair. For the Eastern Ethiopians have straight hair, while they of Libya are more woolly-haired than any other people in the world. Stop! My woolly hair, go! The Dalits believe that their ancestors originated in the Sudan. They believe that from the Sudan, they migrated to the Indus Valley. They see their relationship to Egypt and the Sudan as a link to Afro-Americans and Africans. Yes. Yes. Just because you got people like Kamala Harris. And you think they saw even Kamala Harris. She joined a Black sorority. See? I'm stuttering. They see their relationship as the link of Afro-Americans and Africans. You think they believe allows them to have allies outside of India? Yeah. Where they are harassed and discriminated against? Yeah. Yes, allies. You can't have no allies with the brown. You can only have allies with the Black. You see? When they're always telling you to go and get allies with the Black and brown, they should be saying, like Malcolm X said, have allies with the Black, who you are, see it, you are. Dr. Srinivasan has studied this ancient literature and provide us with keen insight into ancient Nile Valley and the Levant history. Many people will be surprised after reading her major books, Desi, Creed to Egypt, Missing Links of the Rig Veda, and Near Eastern Deities in the Rig Veda, to learn that the Rig Veda, the Ramayana, and other texts are about Nubia and the Dravidians in the Nile Valley. Talk to me, baby. Talk to me. Your world is a Black world, a mighty Black world.
Yes, sir.
You've been conditioned to believe that the only history we got is a history of slavery. The only history we got is a history of selling each other as slaves to second frequency and the Arabs. That's not your history, baby. Your history is universal. Every continent was
Your history is the first history. what happened to us was just a piece of history and a small piece of that history. But our history is the first history because it's the only history. There's only one history, and that's Black history.
That's right. There's only one history. And that's why Second Frequency always trying to write themselves into that history.
That's right.
Many researchers have proven that the Dravidians are related to the C group people of Nubia, given the fact that both groups used a common black and red wear, a common burial complex incorporating megaliths and circular rock enclosures, and a common type of rock cut sepulcher. Black and red wear industry diffused from Nubia across West Asia to Rajasthan, and thence to East Central and South India. Singh made it clear that he believes that the black red wear radiated from Nubia. Look on that right side at the top. We see black and red wear. Then we see the black wear, red wear from South India. Same people, baby.
Same people, different time, but same
That's
people.
That's right. And different hair. Stop.
We've always been here. Not only have we always been here, but we also need to add, we're everywhere.
Everywhere.
So we're everywhere. First here, and we're everywhere. So just like Amma, you say there's no spot where Amma is not. There's no spot where Black is not.
Now, I will admit that they did kill every damn Tasmanian in existence. Mm-hmm. Except for the Tasmanian, we still there. New Zealand, Australia, Samoa, you see? You are a mighty race. I'm not talking to you about being a mighty race based on no damn self-esteem.
Exactly.
I'm giving you the daggone receipts.
I'm giving you your identity back, your original identity back. How can you fight for land and reparations if you don't have the receipts to know who you are and what the land is?
That's right. See?
If you don't have the scholarship of knowing that you can prove who the land belongs to, you just sitting up watching a bunch of YouTube videos.
That's right. And playing games. Mm-hmm. The Dalits identify with their African ancestry. In addition to the Dalits are enamored with Afro-Americans. Yes. The Dalits idolized the Black Panther Party. And do you know what? In 1972, the Dalits formed their own Black Panther Party. It was called the Bombay India. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm. We lead the world. The world looks to us.
Absolutely.
They look us.
Mm-hmm.
Just like I'm giving you our Black history. I gave the Dravidians in India their history.
Wow. That's amazing.
Pretty soon, Dr. Charles, I'm going to have the foundational Black Britons writing their history, baby.
That's right. History.
Foundational Black Britons. I told Sister Shanice last night, you got to go see that show. Like I told her, I said, Sister Shanice, y'all parents may have came from Caribbean. They may have came from Ghana, Nigeria, all over the damn place. But I said, Sister Shanice, you was born in London. Mm-hmm. You were born in England. You are the soil.
That's right.
And I said, Sister Shanice, you know what that means? You are of the soil. You are native to the damn country. And do you know what? Your Black ancestors all over England want to come to you and tell you their history. They want to come to tell you what to write, what to say, what to tell.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
See, those brothers from the Caribbean, they couldn't do it.
Mm-hmm.
Your parents from Africa, they couldn't do it. But you're on the soil. You're foundational Black Britons. FBB. FBB. B1.
So, what role did the church play in the development of Kemet as part of the foundational Black American history and our curriculum?
It played the most important role. The key element in Afro-Americans' understanding of Egypt comes from the church. Yes. The Black church has been a source of healing and comfort for many Afro-Americans. It was here that Black children through Sunday school were taught that the Egyptians were Black Africans and descendants of Ham. I didn't have to go to no damn school.
Mm-hmm,
I first learned in my great history when I was going to Sunday school with my auntie.
Interesting. Wow. Wow.
And they talked about the children of Ham, and she said, Egypt, if the Hamites were Egyptians, and I'm looking on TV every year.
Cleopatra, Ben-Hur, the Bible, Moses, all these white motherfuckers playing Black people. I'm like, what the hell? I knew that back then and I was a baby.
That's right. And every year they made you look at Moses.
That's right, every year.
And so, when I looked at Moses, I didn't see a bunch of second frequency. I knew that they were really playing the role of Black people. Because the Bible told me so. Yes, the Bible told me so.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Fisabilah. If you look at my early writings, I always put Clyde Ahmed Winters. Clyde means he who is heard from afar. Ahmed means praise one, and winter means the cold. So I am Clyde Ahmed Winters because I'm that cold-blooded nigga that you hear from afar. And I tell you something.
Come on now.
I'm going to tell y'all something.
Come on, Doc.
What I tell you today, you ain't going to think too much about it, but I bet you by tomorrow, you're going to say, damn, that was something. Because that's why my name, Clyde, he was heard from afar.
I love that.
You have to sink in first, baby.
Love that, Doc.
Gotta sink in. But listen. No matter what, I can say anything, but I can't down the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
You can talk
leave about that, yeah. Leave that to me. Anyway, moving on.
The Bible, the Quran, they all talking about the same thing. They talking about Black people. So what? But the white man and changed it. The Turk changed it. Those Wahhabis in Saudi Arabia, they changed it. You see, the Quran tell you everything you need to know about the world. But the white man in Pakistan, the white man in Central Asia, and the white men in Saudi Arabia, those white Arabs, they said, this ain't gonna do. We got to put our women down. Even the Christian church want to put the women down. The only place where it's the Black church where the Black woman is standing bold, where the Black woman is standing tall, where the Black woman! See? Don't never say a damn thing about a sister in front of my face.
That's right.
I might be 71 years old, and I might swing at you, and you might get out the way, and I might fall down and need some help to get up. But I'm going to tell you!
That's right. Facts.
Ain't none like a sister.
That's right.
Ain't none like a Black woman. Reverend Matthews and told you about his woman. My woman, I had over 50 years. She's with me now. But the only thing, if she's with me now, I wouldn't probably be doing this. But anyway!
That's true. That's a fact. That is a fact.
Maybe for you it's good. For me it's bad.
I understand. Ashe, we love you. We'll hold you at first frequency light, brother.
But the thing is that, yes, I'm Clyde Ahmed Winters. He was heard from afar. I'm the praise one heard from afar. Cold-blooded. Yeah, some of the stuff I say, it is bad. I used to respect Asim Hotep. But I can't respect a brother. But once his ilk, once his people go back and tell him that I finally finally showed the evidence that Diop did discuss it, then he can tell the truth, and then maybe I can respect him again. But I respect him once he stopped telling those lies. And you, and you followers out there, listen, I give you most of the time, sometimes I don't write a PDF, but I give you a PDF that discuss what I talk about. I give both sides. When I talked last week, when I talked about in a sense the fact that that the Egyptians flew to the moon, I also talked about the fact that they say that that's really just a little tale about SETI I and Ramses II. Mm-hmm. Give you both sides.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So you can think about it.
Mm-hmm.
But you gotta read.
Mm-hmm.
You gotta read. Mm-hmm. See, you gotta read to know the truth. See, yes, the Bible, some things ain't right. A lot of it ain't right, maybe, but some of it is the truth. And when I learned in the Bible about the Hamites, when I learned about ancient Egypt was black, Canaan was black, I knew all world history was black. The ancient history was black. I was about 5 years old. And I knew where I stood. I knew my history. And then when I went to school, when I got to fifth grade, sixth grade, I said, damn, I'm reading about my people, black people. Know your history.
That's right.
Since blacks learned in the church that Ham was the father of the Negro African people, including Egyptians, kept the popular idea among Afro-Americans that the Egyptians were black for the last 200 years. Yes. For 200 years, we've always known. Yeah, we may have played around and talked that stuff. Yazamaza. We look at Moses every Easter, and yeah, we looked at it, but we knew they was just faking. I remember when Michael Jackson, when he made that song, Remember the Time, and then later people found the statue of somebody back then that looked like Michael Jackson. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We've been there, done that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Listen. Me and Reverend Shock trying to tell you that the knowledge is out there. It's inside of you, your genetic memory. Those memories of our past, you were there.
And absolutely.
If you weren't there, somebody in your family was there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So you know the truth. All you need is to touch up on it. That's why I write the books I write. That's why I write the PDFs I write. That's why I do these talks every week.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I'm not getting paid to do this. I'm not getting paid to do this. I don't make no money from YouTube.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I'm doing this because I want to make more researchers to take my place.
That's right. That's right.
I want the Dirty Dozen. I mean, I want
the Dirty 30s.
Dirty 30 to surpass Dr. Winters. All I wanted to say is Dr. Winters was my teacher, but I want you to see that they turning out more than I did.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And when we get through with that class in Britain, watch out, watch out.
Oh, my gosh.
We need a class in Britain. Let me tell you something, Britain.
They're going to tear that. They're going to tear it up. Oof, they're going
to
tear it up.
They won't let them have their own schools. They won't even let you go to school and be a damn teacher. Mm-hmm. Anybody can be a teacher. Get out of here.
Mm-hmm.
You can't have your own schools. They let people write up grants for school. They let the Indians and other people have their own schools. They wouldn't dare let black people have their own schools. They wouldn't let foundational black Britons have their own school because they knew those children was born in Britain because they were born in Britain. They're of the soil. They're foundational black Britons. And they know that if they literally learn their history, they showed it is more the British history than the Anglos and the Saxons.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Baby. The dollars and foundation of black Americans do not look at Egypt solely as a major civilization. They see Egypt as a symbol of the greatness of their ancestral civilization. Egypt to the Dalits and FBA gives them pride in their heritage and recognition that they have not always been poor, downtrodden, beaten down. It also gives foundational Black Americans and Dalits hope that one day they will experience true citizenship without the status of being recognized as different by the dominant cultural groups in India and the United States. Yes. 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 We fight white supremacy because we want to understand that as long as there's white supremacy and racism, we cannot ever have anything. They hate CRT because CRT says that white people have created a race. They've created a race where Black and white people are competing, but in this race, only white people will win. In this race, Black people will never have a chance. But just look at you. Look at you, mighty people. Look at you, mighty race. Look at you. They've done so much to keep us down. Look at what we're doing today. Reverend Matthews had to leave school to take care of his mama. Had to leave sixth grade to take care of his mama. Look at what he's doing now.
Come on now.
Look at what he's giving you. Look at what he's giving us. Don't you tell me that God don't exist.
That's right. That's right.
Don't you tell me that That's God right. don't exist.
Amma exists. Amma is real.
A sixth grade brother had to take care of his mama and have him have a wonderful, exciting platform that can give you the Black Think Tank. This is the only Black Think Tank.
Now, you keep saying that. I don't. Come on now. Really, dude? So, seriously, now, I don't get a chance to watch other people's stuff because I'm too busy producing, but there are other Black Think Tanks that are out here.
Name one.
You're fucking putting me on the spot. I don't know. Family, who's another Black Think Tank that's out here?
Name one. Name another place that's brought on the airwaves as many different Black intellectuals as you have.
Okay. Well, moving on.
I know you're humble.
As Bernie Mac would say, let's move on.
You're humble. There's nothing wrong with being with having humility. But call a spade, baby.
I appreciate you, Doc.
Again, go to my Patreon to see the slides. These slides will be in my Patreon. I was gonna have my Patreon. We were gonna talk tonight, but like I said, I woke up at 2:30. I'm a little too tired. So I don't want to have a chat tonight because I did this talk and Reverend Matthews, he made me get tired.
My fault again? Really? Yeah. Oh, that is really slick. You are good, Doc.
Reverend Matthews has not done anything. I should have found a way to go back to sleep. Twitter is at the Clive Winters 8. Clive Winters, and then go to my YouTube channel. You guys are missing out on some wonderful YouTube videos. Books, Dravidian Connection, Ancient History of Tomorrows in Central Asia, Decipherment of the Olmec Indus Valley Writing, An Unofficial History of the Dravidian Writing, and the Nile Valley History in Rig Veda. What I've been doing is that I've been giving people in my Patreon every month. I have a drawing, and I draw a person and I send them an autographed copy of my book, The World History of Black Race.
Oh, that's awesome!
So if you're in my Patreon, you have an opportunity to maybe win a book autographed copy. Now, because most of my books are published by Kindle Press, which is associated with Amazon. As a result, you will not find my books in too many stores. You had to order Amazon, and so then, but I get copies of the book, I autograph them, and I send it to people in my Patreon, at least one person every month. And I'm really excited about this because I love the fact that these people in my Patreon are ready to give me $5 to support my research. And that's because I have to do this on my own. Nobody's paying me.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's check right.
Yesterday I was on the Sister Denise show. My talk was Europe was a black continent. Check it out. Go to Sister Denise. If you want to hear some more, as you guys say, fire, whatever the hell you guys say. If you want to hear some more fire, you better listen to this.
I'm going to put this in the chat again for the family. This is Sharnista's show. There you go, from yesterday.
Yeah.
Phenomenal.
You know, next week I'm going to be on Sharnista's show, and I'm going to talk about foundational Black Britons. Yes.
Excellent.
On Sister
Sharnista's I'll be there.
Show, I'm going to talk about foundational Black Britons. It's going to be at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, May 25th.
Look at you now.
Next Wednesday.
First Sight Consciousness Family.
Next Wednesday.
Whole Europe.
12 p.m.
That's right.
12 p.m.
Central Standard Time. 10 a.m. my time. Specific.
Don't let that smile fool you.
That's a bad lady right there.
Don't let that smile. And those good looks say, oh, that's not pretty.
You said, don't let those high cheekbones fool you. Don't let those high cheekbones fool you. She's a killer. She'll slay you. Oh, my gosh. She is dangerous.
She's dangerous.
Mm-hmm. She's dangerous
because it is Dr. Marie Childs. It is Dr. Marie Childs who coined the phrase FBB.
That's right.
Black Britain. And she coined that phrase based upon her research.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Let me break it down. 12 p.m. Central, you watch Marie Childs.
She's going to bring that heat. I love it.
And if you're not too excited, come to me at 2.
That's right. That's right. That's right.
And then we're going to set you on fire. Wednesday is going to be hot.
Hot. It's going to be a hot week.
It's going to be a hot week.
It's going to be a hot week. You got a lot of good stuff coming.
We got it coming. And then also don't forget B-Man. He going to do his black room too.
But absolutely. Absolutely.
The main thing is that knowing is winning. Knowing is winning. That's mm-hmm. what this is all about.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
See? That's what this is all about. See? But we need Dr. Marie Childs, because Dr. Marie Childs and Sister Shanice, what they're going to do is they're going to make it so that the foundational Black Britons will know who they are, why they're back there. God don't do nothing without a reason.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
God didn't bring those Caribbean people back to and African people back to Britain so they could have children.
Mm-hmm.
The ancestors made them have children. The ancestors made them come there and have children so that children could be of the soil. And by being of the soil, they was going to have that connection with that British ancestor.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
They go be on the soil. They going to hear it. You may not know this. You probably say, yes, I'll admit, I had to learn a lot of languages to do what I do.
Mm-hmm,
I had to do a lot of research to do what I do. But a lot of this came from the ancestors. The ancestors would talk to me. They wouldn't just sit down to me and say, Clyde, blah, blah, blah. But they would talk to me. They would tell me where to go, where to find
mm-hmm,
it.
Mm-hmm.
You are mighty people. Every one of you out there. So either be trying to learn how to write this history or trying to provide money to people who want to research this history. Buy these PDFs. Buy my books. Buy Dr. Childs' books. Look at Sister Shanice's show. Look at Dr. Childs' show. Know mm-hmm. who you are, know where you go with.
That's right. Love that, Doc. Thank you so much. Wow. Absolutely amazing. Okay. Well, I think this is, you ain't nothing left. We just got to get, have Dr. Winters do our affirmation of power. That's all we have to do is wait for Dr. Winters to repeat the affirmation of power. Isn't that right, Doc?
I don't know. I'm lost.
Oh, now you're hiding again. See how they do me, fam? Every time. This is what I got to go through with this man. All right, family. Okay, well, Dr. Clyde is gone. We're going to do our affirmation of power and close out this amazing session. Another amazing B1 first frequency session. You know who you are. You know that we were first. You know that we are not just the first, but we are everywhere. We were everywhere. We still are everywhere. We are the only matter that matters, because Black matter lives versus Black Lives Matter. And this is what it is. This is what it is. I am honored and proud to be Black, to call myself Black. And Black is not a color, by the way. It's an identity, and it's a heritage. It's an ancestry, rather. So when we use our affirmation of power, we do that to lock in that genetic code, to restore ourselves, to insulate and isolate ourselves from that second frequency signal. So that being said, we simply say, I am one with first frequency.
I am one with first frequency.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the only one.
I am one with the only one.
Ashe.
Ashe.
And so it is.
And so it is.
Family, have an awesome and amazing weekend. We'll see you next week. I literally have a live show, I think, every day next week. So I can't wait. It's going to be some good stuff coming on. We're going to grow and expand with Dr. Winters and Dr. Marie Charles. We'll see you next time on First Frequency of Oneness.